So, as Michael report, I will try to explain you briefly all the hazards that comes from outer space that can affect us not only at infrastructure level for our satellites, but also on ground risks. And these hazards basically comes from three different sources. So we have the sun and its solar flares that can affect our atmosphere and satellites and ground infrastructure. We have the near Earth orbit objects that are basically asteroids. And the third one is something that we have caught, which actually is the space debris. So all the satellites that we are launching and the problem that is, I'm going to minimize this. Yeah. So let's start with the program. So the objective is to protect our life, no matter if it's life or assets. And we covered in these three segments. So the space weather segment will be in charge of sun hazards, near Earth orbit will be in charge of asteroid hazards and space debris and clean space that is trying to remediate the space debris problem that cares about the satellite's debris. And basically, as you can see in this image, we have several activities that are carrying out in these segments. So we have the space weather providing services, Lagrange mission that is a satellite that will help us in the monitoring and forecast with quite in advance all the warnings that comes from the sun. From the NEO side, we have how we monitor asteroids. So they are building Fire telescopes. They are planning as well what is called HERA mission that try to understand how we can deflect an asteroid if for some reason it's causing a problem, a menace to the Earth. And then everything related to space debris, which goes from how we operate satellites, like collision warnings, to maneuver the satellites to avoid a space debris, how we categorize and monitor this space debris, and how we can mitigate this problem. So in ESA, we are funded by Ministerial Council that is happening every 3 years. Last one was last year, and we were succeed, and we got quite an increase in the budget. So hence all these kind of different activities that will try to minimize the risk for us. So let's start for the space weather. So the objective is to detect and forecast space weather events and the potential effects. And these potential effects can be in terms of magnetosphere induction currents that may affect as well on ground, but also radiation risk and the sun solar winds. All these expertise are gathering, we call them services. And they provide these services via hub, that is so the coordination center that is settled in Redouville in Belgium. And will basically what it is it's doing, it's collecting all the expertise from a federal network of space research institutes that are expert in the subtopics of the sun, like solar weather, atmospheric weather. All that information is collected by this coordination center and publicly available under this URL. So you can, I put here the URL so you can take a look in there after the talk if you are interested in. This is not everything is a hazard coming from the sun. We also get benefits of these magnificent auroras. And this is a very nice view from the ISS. We are used to see the auroras from ground. But from the ISS, the beauty is even, from my point of view, much than from ground. We have learned that the sun behaves in peaks. So we have every 11 years the same pattern, and we have the peaks every 11 years. So from hazard point of view, we don't like these points because it may cause, and as I will show you later, some damages. However, from a space debris point of view, we are very interested in these peaks because this will help us to naturally re-entering objects in the Earth, and hence we reduce the space debris. I will link this slide, so keep in your mind later when I speak about the space debris. So, as I said, in 2003, we had a peak of that, and there was a flare, as we'll see now in this video, that reached the Earth, and because it was quite massive, corona mass ejection. And it impacted quite heavily, not only in satellites assets. So basically, we lost some satellites. We experienced some reduction on the mission objectives of some others, but also on ground. Some of the aviation air traffic was restricted, and there were some also damage in a transformer and even in nuclear power plants. So this is telling us that we should take a much closer eye to the sun and the effects that the sun can cause on us. Take a look in this one. So this is an artistic impression of how the corona ejection reaches our magnetosphere, interact our magnetosphere, and sometimes it can create some induction currents that will cause problems. So far, we have in situ monitoring of the condition of the sun when we place the satellites in this called Lagrange point. So if you see in this figure, it's a point between the Earth and the sun. However, from the video I showed you before, the artist impression, if we decide to put a satellite in this other Lagrange point, an unstable point, we can forecast or help the forecast of the menace coming from the sun, because we will support the in situ measurement together with around 10 minutes, 15 minutes pre-warm that something will impact the Earth. So a space weather segment is working now in developing this mission. They got the approval, and then they are moving forward to the construction of the satellite. Next topic is the near-Earth object segment. So the objective of this segment is to identify asteroids, comets, meteorites, and try and estimate the potential collision risk that might happen with the Earth. We are talking about all natural space objects that are around, I mean, that can collide with the Earth orbit. And also, it supports on the alarms and how we can mitigate this menace coming from the asteroids. This is a figure that captures all the already detected asteroids. Most of them are here in this region, that is the asteroids belt between Mars and Jupiter. The theory says that this potentially could have been a planet, but because of the gravity of the outer massive planets, this couldn't happen. And then we have this cloud that, of course, is interacting with our orbit around the sun. We have a lot of evidence of this existence. So we have fireballs crossing the skies in the newspapers every 2 or 3 weeks, more or less. You can see some news on this. But we have as well evidence of the impact of those asteroids when they reach them, because maybe for those, the atmosphere didn't destroy them. So this one is a very characteristic one. So the diameter of this crater is 1.2 kilometers, so it's impressive. And it was estimated that the asteroid diameter was only 50 meters, but the atmosphere couldn't destroy it. So this can cause a lot of, I mean, actually, this caused a lot of destruction in terms of environment. You may, all of you, remember this one, the Chelyabinsk in 2013. So this was a massive asteroid. It was only, I think, 5 meters. It exploded at 30 kilometer height. So it was not really very far away from ground. And the energy that it released, it was around 30 times the Hiroshima bomb. So imagine if that could hit the Earth, and Scott, that the atmosphere sometimes help us. But even though it created a lot of damage, and I will. And this is a video, very nice video, how the effect of the expansion wave affected the infrastructures on ground. Then this table summarizes some facts on the how the diameter, how the impact energy will cause a diameter of an EO that cannot be, that is not destroyed in the atmosphere and enters, the typical interval that we have identified as they are appearing in our history, and the potential effect. So just to to relax you a bit, it's like we need a 10-kilometer satellite, asteroid impacting the Earth, not even destroyed, but the amount of energy released is super massive, and this could end the human civilization. The theory says that dinosaurs disappear because one of these type of asteroids impacting us. You can check more. I mean, I couldn't update because this is always the demo effect, the number, because the portal for some reason is down today. But regularly it shows you how many known asteroids we know, and they include a risk list of these NEOs, where they are encouraging astronomers to look at them in order to refine the orbit and compute associated risk of potential impact with the Earth. But as I said, most of the NEOs are still unknown, so it's a real menace. How we can mitigate a potential threat coming from a NEO towards the Earth? So there are several deflection strategies, like explosive strategies or gravity tractor, kinetic or ion beam shepherd methodologies that can provoke a very tiny movement in the asteroid. But as I put in here, just a change in, with 3 centimeters per second may move the position by 14,000 kilometers in 15 years. So just a slightly impact could save us of a potential impact from them. And here is the mission where ESA is working on, which is the HERA mission. It's a combined mission with NASA. So NASA will release the Dark Impact satellite into Didymos, which is a binary asteroid. And a HERA mission basically will go after in order to measure what this impact of this asteroid, of this satellite in the asteroid provoked. And like that, refine our models and put and think on potential mitigation measurements for the future. This is a very nice YouTube video. I encourage you to look after the presentation where Brian May from The Queen music bands explained very nicely the concept of the HERA mission. And the other branch where the NEO people are working on is to augment the capacity of observation. And for that reason, they are going to build a network of what they call fly-eye telescopes, because the cameras is going to be a very large field of view telescope, and is composed by 16 cameras. So acting like, if you see this picture, it seems to be a fly eye. And that's the reason why the network is fly eye called. Right now they are deploying the first of these ones and in Italy. So in coming months, we will maybe see some pieces of news in the press. And now I'm going to talk about my domain of expertise, which is the space debris. So before starting to talk about the facts, number, how we observe, how we mitigate, what is the space debris? So we need to define what the space debris is. And it's everything that is man-made, including fragments and elements thereof, like this one, for example, that was released from a launch in Earth orbit or re-entering the atmosphere. And this is crucial, non-functional. So since the era of we started the space era from with the Sputnik launch, we have already launched more than 5,000 successful launches. And we need to keep a track on those. And so hence we have a catalog of orbital elements from several space surveillance networks. The two main ones are the USA one, that is called SSN, SSN, and the Russian one, that they have a network of different type of sensors around the world and monitor and track constantly the objects. However, with the technologies that we have on ground, we can only observe objects above 10 centimeters. And they are publicly available, and it is provided by United States. And but it's only about 20,000 objects. And from this graph, you can see that it only represents a very small part of the global issue that we are suffering. So from that 20,000 tracked objects, we have only 6% of operational satellites. The rest is called debris, and it can be because they are already defunct satellites, rocket bodies, upper stage, mission-related objects, and fragments caused by collisions or breakups. It is estimated that this is a very nice video of the evolution of the space debris. So we have it's going to show you how the number is increasing in terms of the size of the objects. So you can see that the most crowded area is what we call the low Earth observation orbit, where all the meteorological satellites and nowadays communication network satellites are being deployed, and it's started to be quite congested. Then we have the geo region, where all our communication satellites are in place. And now you can see what we have tracked. So this is showing you the current state of the already tracked population of more than 10 centimeter size objects. But it is estimated to be more than 1 million objects for very, very small. I will accelerate the video. So here, so this is the quantity. I mean, we are thinking about that there are particles of between 1 millimeter to 1 centimeter to be around 100 million of these objects. And if you think that this cannot cause a problem, I will try to show you that it's not the case, unfortunately. This is the current tracked object population. So keep in mind the 10 centimeter size objects. We in the Space Debris Office release in yearly basis the current state of space debris, and this chart is extracted from there. So since the first moment we released the Sputnik until now, there are two big events that increased drastically and exponentially our population of debris. One was the destruction of Fengyun in 2007. This was an intentional destruction. So there was a Chinese meteorological satellite, and they would like to demonstrate that they could shoot a ballistic missile to the satellite and destroy it, and they succeed. However, this caused a 3,000 objects cloud that increased exponentially the population. And the second event was the collision between two defunct satellites, one Russian Cosmos and the American one Iridium, that create a 2,000 objects cloud. And I'm pretty sure that every month you have already read some news in the press. Recently, actually, it was last week, of potential risk of collision on between satellites. So unfortunately, this is coming more trendy than in the past. But we somehow are a bit lucky because of the atmosphere. So all those objects that are in the low Earth orbit can be re-entered naturally thanks to the drag in the atmosphere. So this chart tried to show the number of objects that re-entered. What I can just highlight from this plot is that most of them are in the LEO object, orbit only. So we are somehow releasing a bit that orbit, but it's not the solution. There are, apart from the breakups on the on-purpose destruction satellites or collisions, there are other space debris sources, like the ones that coming from the solid rocket motor firing that release particles of aluminium, and as well from the coolant release events like sodium, potassium, of other type of engines. But you see the particles are very, very small. Nevertheless, I will show you they are dangerous. We could observe directly in situ how these little particles can affect the function of a certain satellite. And when the Hubble Space Telescope had to be repaired of the optic, the astronauts took the opportunity as well to repair the solar panels. And they brought ground pieces of those solar panels that would allow us to observe the micro tiny impact everywhere. And this is very useful for us to validate our models, because for these tiny particles, we cannot observe from ground, hence we have to model them. And in order to validate the models, we need this kind of proofs. So more images on how the Hubble was impacted everywhere, like in the solar arrays, even in the antenna. Even the Kepler is also a menace to satellites, because, I mean, astronauts can go outside. Actually, there is one of the debris is a screw that one of the astronauts in one of his work accidentally released. And so that Kepler may cause problems. This is a reality that we suffer in ESA with Sentinel 1A. So basically, flight dynamics team observe a tumble in the attitude of the satellite. Then it was followed by a decrease on the solar energy that they got from the solar panels. And they say, okay, let's do something. Let's try to switch on again the camera that it was only foreseen to be on to demonstrate that the depletion of the solar panel happened correctly. And then they realized that there was a hole here that had been caused by a space debris. This graph is actually very interesting, and it shows all the problems in a row. So we are in the x-axis, we are showing the size in logarithmic way in order to highlight the differences of the objects and the number of all those objects. So as I said, for objects above 10 centimeter, we are fine. Somehow we can track them. We have means to observe them. For the rest, we don't have observation. Hence, we have to rely on models like the one that we are using in the agency that's called MASTER. A particle of less than 1 millimeter is expected to be on this order of magnitude. There are a lot of them. And this can impose some surface degradation. If we go between the window from 1 millimeter to 1 centimeter, it might happen penetrations. Between 1 centimeter to 10 centimeters, you can even lose completely the mission, or even worse. So these are the threats that we are trying to face with. I mean, we don't have observation what we can do in this region that may impact severely the mission objectives. Just to tell you the amount of trash basically that we have on above of our heads. So we are counting almost more than 6,000 tons. Of course, everything comes from the larger size objects, but nevertheless, the numbers of the others for the smallers are quite impressive. This is to show you, I mean, this is a on-ground test that we performed on to demonstrate hypervelocity impacts. And basically, this bullet of aluminium ejected at this speed, at the typical speeds of the satellites, you can see how it can penetrate. And it's quite impressive to see this on ground, and you can imagine what can happen to a satellite. And actually, this is part of a satellite. Imagine the satellite to have all these five seals plugged together. And so the boy was ejected, and it was even almost to penetrate to the other side, which is the pressured side of the satellite. So if that happened, then you lose your mission. So how we observe all this space? So we have the sporadic detection, statistical counts based on models or some onboard cameras to model the objects between the very tiny ones and one centimeter. And then from 10 centimeter onwards, we rely on catalogs provided by the different surveillance sensors. So we have the one provided by US, but there are some commercial trends now, like LEO Labs, that they are building radars in different parts of the globe, of the Earth. And we can rely as well in some new ones that the ASCAT is building in Sweden. This is the Space Surveillance Network from US. So you can see that they have most of the sensors are in the North Hemisphere, but we have some of them as well in the Southern. These are the different European sensors that we are collaborating with. So in the optics, we have several in different countries. We have to distinguish between survey and tracking. So this survey type, basically you point your sensor towards a certain region in the sky, and you just wait until something passes in the field of view. This helps you to build up a catalog, but the accuracy of those orbits are going to, or measurements are not going to be that nice. In order to maintain the catalog, we need more accurate orbits, and that's the reason why we track the orbit. So once you know, you detect for the first time an object, you have to track it in a more accurate way in order to refine the orbit. The same happens with radars and with laser stations are mainly for tracking, but for the radars it's exactly the same. We have survey and tracking radar and even different configuration of radars. So this is a one that we have here next to Madrid in Santorcaz. This one is the OGS in Tenerife. That actually is being shared with the NEO community. So part of the month, it's used to try to discover new asteroids, and part of the month to categorize and try to observe objects in the GEO region. This is another one, TIRA. This is in Germany, and it allows you also to make images. So this helps a lot in order to identify how a defunct satellite or debris is behaving, because when you lose the control of a satellite, the object is stumbling. And hence, to characterize that attitude motion, we need this support nice techniques. This is an observation from the OGS, so all the characteristics, I think, is not worth to enter in. But these are the typical images that you get. All these streaks are the stars, and then you are following the objects and you see it as a point-like image. Another one that we have in Cebrero, so here as well in Spain, and is going to be a second one deployed in Chile, is a robotic telescope prototype. And the idea is to have one in the Northern Hemisphere and another one in the Southern Hemisphere, and try to monitor several times in a day, you first start in this night, and then when in our site starts the night, you can try to reacquire the observation. So more information about the telescope. These are as the other one of the OGS, is the same. You can see very tiny dots there and that are satellites. The rest are the stars. For the radars, there are several techniques. So you can rely on monostatic approach or biostatic approach. And the type of images that you got, they are not images, the type of measurement you got from a radar are actually the echoes. So a radar sends a pulse towards an object, and then it measures the echo. And from that, you can extrapolate how the movement of the object is. So usually this is the typical range course that you can obtain from a radar. So as the object is approaching towards the Earth, you will have the minimum range. So it is the minimum distance the object was to the Earth, and then how it escapes again. And this is a very nice one with the Santor Cat radar that we managed to show in a row. A constellation of three satellites, the swarms, when they were launched for the first time. So we saw the three smileys in the plot that were was meaning a success. So, but we need to live with the space debris. So how we model, so we have to understand the sources of the space debris, as I already mentioned in previous slides. We need to create a database where all the events that are created in the space debris are stored. We have to simulate and try to derive object population, and we have to propagate in order to compute the orbits at a different epoch. And for that, we use the master model. The sources of space debris are a lot of them. I mean, since the launch, you have the upper stage, the payloads, or mission-related objects. For example, when you launch an observatory, at certain point, the cover of the camera is released. So that cover is a mission-related object, and therefore a space debris. Then we have to cope with fragmentation that can happen accidentally, like explosions or collisions, or even other sources are like the tiny particles I mentioned before, the from the different fighting sources. But we have some natural things that, thanks God, helps us to control a bit the situation, which are the atmospheric drag and some perturbation. So this one, the solar radiation pressure, is that the one is of us, because when we have this peak in the sun evolution cycle, we observe a lot of more re-entries than other periods. And we have now starting to investigate on active removal of the debris. So for the collisions, we have, as far as we know, four of them. So the most critical one was this one that I already mentioned before, between these two different satellites. But this is starting to be a growing problem. So even, I mean, recently we have seen that we increased the collision warnings. Fragmentation events. Only last year, we compute to be created, I mean, almost 2,000 more objects just because of the events. And the problem of a fragmentation event is that it creates a cloud. I mean, I can put it again. It creates a cloud when it happens, this fragmentation, and all these tiny objects and fragments created get embedded in the active satellite orbit, causing a lot of problems into their operations. The breakups, this is a chart that I extracted from the Space Environment Report, and which is to highlight is that most of the problems are caused by propulsion. So there are some accidental explosion due to the fuel, and sometimes as well from electrical, like batteries, or that maybe have been affected by a solar flare and induce a current that creates the explosion. But we have some of them that is still unknown. But this is to pay attention. A deliberate breakup causes are around 11%. And recently, I don't remember it was this year or last year, there was an intentional destruction test was conducted by India. And they managed to, they thought that just launching a small CubeSat at lower altitude orbits didn't interfere with the others could solve the problem. However, when you impact these sets of very low Earth orbits, then you release some objects above. So even if you think that you are not going to create any problem on the above orbits, actually it's just the opposite. the particles from a solid I already mentioned, and this as well. And so, and this is again the same figure as before. So very tiny particles can cause problems, and we have a lot of them. So we are now facing more and more with degradation in the surface and potential loss of the emissions because of the degradation of the solar panels, like the one by the Sentinel one I mentioned before. But we are starting to get to be in a very high number of very large pieces that can destroy completely the satellite, and even worse, create even more debris. So how we operate in this congested and special environment? So we need to understand where the different objects are, and we cannot know precisely. What we can know is the state vector or ephemerates of the so the position at different epochs and the uncertainty of that. And usually the uncertainty is measured by an ellipsoid. And so the major uncertainty always is along track. And basically, what we compute is which is the collision probability. If the collision probability is above a threshold by the guidelines is around 10 to minus 4, then we recommend always to act to conduct a maneuver in order to try to avoid the collision. So this is an example that happened. We conducted in ESA with the EMVSAT. It was compute a probability threshold above the T minus 4 to be collide with an upper stage. Then there were some on calls with the flight dynamics team, and we told them please make a evasion maneuver in order to avoid the satellite. So they just fired a bit in order to increase the orbit, and then after the simulation, the distance was safe enough, and we didn't have any problem. Another problem that we have is the reentries. Most of them are uncontrolled reentries, but some of the satellites, like ATV, are designed to be re-entered in a controlled way, like that we guarantee that the satellite is destroyed in the atmosphere and didn't and doesn't pose any problem or menace to the Earth. And this is I mean a nice record of that is the ATV re-entry re-entering and destroying in the Earth, so it was no problem on Earth. But unfortunately, there are sometimes it happens that we can find evidence that it hits on ground, and usually are related to the upper stage of the rocket bodies. They are designed in a certain way, I mean, spherical and cylindrical shapes that are hard to be destroyed in the atmosphere. This is that most of the reentries are uncontrolled. Not, I mean, I want to prevent you that this is not showing you all the impact on Earth. It's just all the reentrant objects, which makes a difference. Thanks God, most of them are concentrated around the equator, where the massive Pacific Ocean is, and hence all the most of the reentries happens here, so it doesn't pose any no risk to life. This is the yearly reentry mass per object. So when we have the peaks of the solars is when we have the peaks of the reentry mass. So in I mean it's nice to see, sorry, it's nice to see that a lot of mass has been already reentered. But in numbers, the vast majority in a controlled way. We make a lot of reentry predictions. So we have this interagency space debris coordination office where we conduct several reentry campaigns where all these entities are together trying to monitor till the last moment when an object is about to reenter. So at the beginning of the observation campaign, the uncertainties in the prediction of the epoch and the place are hard, I mean, are very, very large. And as we are getting close to the event itself, it helps you to the uncertainty and can somehow safely set when it's going to happen. So how we mitigate all these, I mean, the long-term consequences? I mean, we are, so this is, there is someone with the microphone on. Could you please mute? So we have this Kessler syndrome that actually is a feedback position, so it's a cascade effect. So if you increase the, I'm sorry, there is someone with the microphone on and it's quite disturbing while I'm speaking.
Yes, a little.
Yeah. Well, I will try to not being disturbed about that. So as soon as we are increasing our launches, we increase the collision probability. And by increasing the collision probability, we increase the population. So it's a cascade effect, and it's called the Kessler syndrome because Dr. Kessler was the first one. He's an astrodynamic guy from NASA that in the 80s, he started to raise his voice to point out this potential problem. So what happens if we continue business as usual, meaning that we continue launching at the same rate that we are doing? We are going to augment these collision probabilities. And if the collision happens, we are going to have more objects. And the trends are exponential. So we have to do something. But what will happen if we decide not to launch anymore? And we don't implement any mitigation guidelines. This won't prevent to reduce the space debris population, just the opposite. It will still occur some collisions and the population will still growing. So this means that we need to implement some mitigation in order to try to reduce this problem and not being cut it from getting outside the space to the space again. So the mitigation scenarios, so just in graphs, so it's basically the same as the video. If we continue the business as usual, but if we implement some of these mitigation guidelines that I will explain you, then we see that we reduce the number of objects. So we need to somehow to promote these guidelines and application everywhere in the community. So how we can mitigate? There are some parts where we have already reacted. So the meteorites is something that we cannot prevent. I mean, they are so small that you have to live with them. But you can protect your satellite. So you can put some shields in order to limit the impact. We can as well stop the usage of these kind of motors, engines that are releasing these particles, like the aluminium ones. So we can go for aluminium-free propellants. We can even try to limit the exposure time to space. And we can help operation by collision avoidance and by conducting disposals of the satellites. However, this is increasing quite a lot because of the mega constellations of satellites like the ones of Starlink that I'm pretty sure that you have spotted and on our skies recently. So we need to tackle this issue because this is increasing too much. And then we can already mitigate the explosions. So we basically, what we conduct now is that whenever a satellite arrives to the end of its life, they have to pass evade. And what that means? So the remaining fuel has to be ejected. And once that it happens, then you deactivate your batteries. And like that, you avoid any potential current inductance fragments. How the number of objects will increase if we continue to launch as we are. If we guarantee that all the satellites get the passivation, we are still having a problem. But if we combine that all of them we ensure have been passivated and we implement post-mission disposal maneuvers, we start to stabilize. And if on top of that we add active debris removal, about 5 objects per year, I'm talking about large objects in here, is at the moment that we bend the curve. So there are some mitigation guidelines. So in many standards and regulations, we limit the number of objects that you can release related to the emission, like the cover to the cameras I mentioned before, how you have to passivate the upper stage, how you have to move your geosatellite whenever it goes to the end of its life to what we call a great yard. So basically we're postponing the problem. We are moving the telescope, or sorry, the satellite into a upper orbit out of the gravity Earth influence. And there is the limit of the presence in the LEO orbit to a maximum of 25 years. In some of their standards, they go further and they put some limits on ground risk. They give you some guidelines on how to active condition maneuvers performances and limit the release of these nasty engines on the aluminium in slag and dust. And under discussion, we have the active removal of objects. So the two protected regions I mentioned, the LEO, so you have to guarantee that if you want to launch a satellite in this region in 25 years, it has to re-enter. And to ensure that, you have to keep a percentage of the fuel in order to perform the last maneuver that can guarantee that. And the geo region, whenever your satellite is about to end of complete the mission in this region, you have to move forward to the graveyard orbit. If we just some numbers, if this is the typical satellite that we have in the LEO orbit in 800 kilometers altitude. If we have a defunct satellite of a very tiny, I mean, this is not this is the typical size of the satellites at that height, it's going to cost 100 years to re-enter. And even the smaller particles, like 1 centimeter, 20 years. So we have to impose some maneuvers at the end of the life of these satellites in order to guarantee the 25 years. For the GEO disposal, we have to ensure that the GEO provider satellites are compliant with the IEDC guidelines. And what we have observed, this is growing. Most of them are compliant, but we are still a bit far away from having the 100%. So we have to still push more guidelines, standards, and rules that will bind suppliers of satellites to be compliant with this. This is a satellite from ESA, IRS2, that wanted to be the demonstrator how performing a last maneuver will help you to be compliant with the 25 years guideline. So basically you perform a last maneuver, then you reduce the lower your height. Here, going at this height, you guarantee that in 25 years, your object will be re-entered. But during 25 years, it will cause problems, of course. I mean, you have to, it's always a balance. And once you arrive at the lowest point, then it's at that time when you passivate your satellite. So you deplete completely the fuel, and then you remove the batteries. But we are suffering the mega constellations, as I mentioned before. So we are, I mean, actually these numbers are increasing more. They are thinking Starlink requested for 40,000 satellites. It's nice. It will provide internet coverage around the world. However, it's causing a lot of problems, and they are quite obscure in the way they ensure that they are doing collision avoidance maneuvers and they have that capacity on board, but they are not really transparent, and it's always causing a lot of problems. And even more, they are not following completely the rules on terms of the criticality of the components. Basically, they have said that one out of 10 of the satellites that they will launch, it will fail. So this is telling us that we are going to have a massive problem in coming years. Not only in space debris problems, but as well astronomers. Astronomers are quite worried about how this will affect their observation, because nowadays they are seeing in the field of views massive trails of these satellite constellations. But we are working on that, and we are making close collaboration between different entities, agencies, member states around the world. Everything started with the guidelines by the IDDC. And from there, several code of conduct was driven by the mainly European agencies. We have delivered the requirements. And then we are adopting and evolving the ISO standards and how we can mitigate the debris, but not only in the design of the satellite, but as well in the operation of the satellites in all the phases. So since the design of the satellite till the disposal of the satellite and of its life. And how Europe is as well doing the effort to adopt the ISO standards and try to compile all the mitigation guidelines. Having said this, how we can remediate this space debris problem? So basically, the payloads, I mean, the optical solar panels, this cannot be protected. So we have to just rely on likelihoods. Tanks, yes, we can do things. We can passivate, we can remove the field, and it can exploit even though. We can protect the structure with Weibull seals. And for unmanned missions, the already on operational satellites can perform collision avoidance, but this has to be limited somehow because this is increasing too fast. So that's the at the moment we arrive to implement in ESA the clean space, and it's trying to tackle the problem in three areas. It's trying to tackle the what is called eco design, so it means how we can make most green technology in all the phases of the satellite mission. So since the launch, I mean since the design with the materials, toxicity of the components, etc. To even the launch, trying to minimize the fuel and the all the costs that we can imagine. Then the other one is to improve technologies that can help us to have a more eco design, and also try to design for the miss. What this means, to try to use, to invest technology in materials, how guarantee that they will degrade if they go through the atmosphere, and then that you can guarantee that you are not creating more space debris than the minimum required. And then there is the fourth, there's already the third branch, which is the active day removal. So here we need to understand how the defunct object is behaving in terms of attitude, so tumbling motion. So you have to get really very close to the object, try to make a rendezvous. Then you have to capture, so you have to test different technologies that I will show you, and then you have to guarantee the re-entry. So in these active debris removal technologies, there are some of them on study. You can approach to a satellite by LIDAR, trying to reduce the attitude motion, or even by the pressure of a light. And once you have stabilized the motion of the satellite, it's when you can start thinking to get much closer and try to use methods like this one with a robotic arm, or the one that is going to be shown in some seconds, like a clutch or solar sails, or even like harpoons, or with nets. Like these ones. These technologies have been already successfully demonstrated, the one for the Harpoon and the network by the reorbit, the remove debris satellite mission conducted by Airbus. There are some nice videos in YouTube that you can check. And then this will help us to reduce the problem that we are facing by re-entering in a very safe way. But this is still on study phases. So that's all from my part. I think that I managed to do it on time. So thank you very much for your attention. And in case you have further questions, you can raise now your hand or you can write me an email and I will be very happy to answer.
Yeah, many thanks, Beatrice. Very nice presentation. I'm always fascinated by the videos, and I'm also a little bit worried by the graphics. With
yes,
a lot of
yes.
dots of the debris always.
Actually, after the slides, if you are more interested, watch this YouTube video. That is a video that we created in the Space Debris Office to promote. A conference that we have every 2 years. The next one is going to happen next April, virtually, I have to admit. And it's very nice. So you will see, actually, this is a summary of all my presentations. Go to the question, sorry.
So can you see the questions in the chat or shall I?
Let me open it. Yes, I can show them, but I didn't pay attention to them, I have to admit, otherwise. So I have to go one by one, or...?
Yeah, please, if you can. So there's this...
Yeah, that's actually one of the comments I made, that we are seeing problems with astronomy. And actually, there are some astronomers from ESO, if I recall correctly, have created a report on how they need some laws or legislations that will guarantee dark skies. It's quite a hot topic right now. Clear space, that's it. That's what is intended, the clean space. So that the idea is to be the first service contract to do that. So the people that actually know quite a lot. Sorry, I couldn't hear you properly. Could you repeat?
No, I think it was just a...
Oh, okay.
Microphone.
Okay.
No.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think I couldn't see more questions. So.
No, I think this was most of it. I personally always have the question because I'm really worried about this. Large constellations like SpaceX or
yes, Starlink.
Because as far as I've understood from your talk, there's nothing to regulate them for the moment. No,
there are regulations in. They had when you are the manufacturer of a satellite and you want to put something on orbit, you have to request a permission. And in case of United States satellite providers, is the FAA. So the Federal Aviation Administration, and they got a green light. However, they are now trying to mitigate how this will impact, and there are some. Actually, there are some nice. Discussions at political level, because this always is try to balance the government implication with the commercial, and the trend is on the commercial side right now, but we need to put regulations. There are some countries like France, for example, that included in their set of laws as a country, some laws on space debris. So we are moving forward there, but there's still a lot to do, a lot. then you have to trust the satellite manufacturers if they tell you that they plan to build such a constellation, but with certain guarantees that they will cover certain risks, then you have to trust them. So yeah, it's a balance, but of course a lot of things to do still in legislation. But there are active working groups, and in terms of standards, there are a lot of effort in there.
Okay, Beatriz, many thanks again.
You're welcome.
So let's go to the next topic, which is.
Michele, it is another now. Question in the chat, the last one, I think.
Why not to use something with origami for me? Less debris. It's not a problem of volume, actually, or actually it's even worse. I mean, if you remember some of the graphs, the smallest pieces are causing the most danger. So even for, I mean, and actually what is happening is that we are facing a miniaturization of the space market. Before, at the beginning of the era of space, everything was big satellites. With a very powerful payload, and right now we are moving to smaller satellites in constellations. So and try to decouple the different payloads around the network, and this is causing more, CubeSats, for example. That's it. So and this is causing even more problems because with CubeSat you can, I mean, there are some efforts now in technology level on providing them maneuverability. With little engines, but usually these kind of satellites cannot maneuver, so you cannot avoid any kind of collision warning. So actually, the smaller we get, from my point of view, the most risk we have to cover.